My name is Bastien. I work for Red Hat and I work on GNOME. We do quite a bit of work on hardware enablement these days, writing drivers, fixing up laptops, that sort of thing. And I'm going to talk to you about my experience buying a beige rail tablet about a year ago. Sometime in September 2014, I bought a Chinese off-brand tablet, the Honda V975W. It's a pretty nice tablet, very light, with a form factor that resembles more popular products from a Cupertino-based company. It looks very much like an iPad. And the first thing that I tried to do when I got that tablet was obviously trying to run Linux on it and trying to run GNOME on it, because I'm not really interested in using Windows. That tablet doesn't run Android, and I tried to get things working. So one of the first things that I did was try to get the wireless working, because a tablet without any means to communicate to the outside is going to be a bit problematic. So I got a code drop from Realtek. They sent me a zip file with a whole lot of data. Started poking at the driver, trying to make it work. And me and a couple of other folks started cleaning up this driver. This is the latest changes that we made. There's 250,000 lines of code in that driver. That's probably more than an awful lot of applications that we run every day on GNOME. I don't know how many lines of code LibreOffice has, but this is probably the size of one of the modules. We managed to shave off about 140,000 lines of code, removing support for pre-production versions of the devices, USB support, because this particular Wi-Fi driver was actually connected through SDIO, and we cleaned it up. It's, to give you an idea, most of the Wi-Fi drivers that you can get that support only one device are probably about 5,000 lines of code. So this is still 15, maybe 20 times too big, with 90,000 lines of code. The problem was that driver was probably working very well when they tested it on Android, for example. It was probably very stable when you had all the right patches, non-upstream patches, obviously, inside the kernel. But we got to a point where the machine, for example, was crashing, or it got down to 1 or 2 kilobytes a second, so your really awful performance. And we thought, well, we need to find a way to make it easier to debug. There's only so many times that you can unplug and replug the USB network adapter. And we got to the point where we'd be able to use USB on the go. USB on the go is a protocol that makes it easy to switch between two modes. Either you are a master, that means that you are a fully fledged computer, that's what your desktop machine can do. And you can switch into a slave mode or client mode. And that particular mode is what you would have on devices. That means everything that you would plug into your computer and access from the computer. So that's going to be your mice. That's going to be your external devices. All in all, so you can switch easily between the two, and this is what you get. For example, on Android devices, you would plug in. If you plug it into the computer, then the computer controls the Android device. If you plug it into, for example, to a mass storage, then you're going to be able to access with my storage. So USB on the go, yeah, pretty cool. And I started working on ATBD. ATBD is the Android, trying to remember.
Debug breach.
Thank you. The Android debug breach daemon. So this is the thing that usually runs on your developer device on Android. I made some changes to the upstream ATBD, trying to get it running on the GPC, making some changes so they would work with systemd. All the patches are gonna be there for now. I'm gonna try and upstream the more upstreamable fixes. So the good thing is that once you get that running, you can debug hangs and all the other sort of bugs that you might encounter with my wireless driver. I can just do ADB shell, get a shell on the remote device, on the tablet, and start hacking at it. Another thing that we try to do to make it easier is try to get EFI Mix working. EFI Mix is a feature of the Linux kernel. You've got, because of Microsoft and because of firmware vendors, on the machines that support UEFI, you would have either a 32-bit firmware that can boot a 32-bit version of Windows, or you would get a 64-bit firmware that can boot a 64-bit version of Windows. It turns out that because the CPU can be 64-bit, as most Atom CPU, State Trail, whatever you get nowadays from Intel is going to be 64-bit, you can fake it, so you've got a 32-bit version of the firmware, and you will jump into the 64-bit kernel. That means that you end up running the 64-bit OS on the tablet, and the good thing about that is that it's the exact same software that you would be using on your desktop machine or your laptop. So once you get support for EFI Mix, we can make some changes to Grub, we can make some changes to Shim, which would enable us to use secure boot on those machines, and you can make changes to some Fedora-specific applications to make sure that all the 32-bit Grub UEFI support is going to be built into the 64-bit distribution. You make some changes from the Congress of Aid installs the 32-bit version of the EFI loader, and then you can boot from a generated image directly into a 64-bit OS. And then there's HDG app. So this is the part where it gets really interesting for developers. We can already access the tablet through ADB shell. We can poke at it. ADB is also used on Android devices to sideload applications. So sideloading is basically you're pushing a blob of data onto the Android device and you can actually load it. You don't need to go through the Play Store. This is usually what you get on Android and iOS devices. If you've got unsigned applications, you would force it into developer mode, load the application on the side. I know that this might break my phone, and you just carry on, you can use it. This is what you usually do for testing your application that you're developing. So ADB, and therefore ADBD has got a mode where you can install APK, that's the Android application packages. We've got HCG app. HCG app can install applications locally. That works very well. Well, we can make some changes to our own version of ADBD and get it to install bundles from HCG app. So you could do something like you know, ADB install with the exact name of your bundle, and it will be deployed to the tablet. And this is me and my wife thinking about what just happened. If you saw at the end of the talk, there was a little something saying that this was a true story. And this is a true story just in the same way that Fargo is a true story. It's not a true story, it's suspension of disbelief. So, as you can imagine, not everything happened exactly the way that I explained to you. I know people that are very clever. I know people that know more about drivers than I do. And when I was trying to debug why performance was so awful, why the tablet was hanging, why everything wasn't working properly, then I got in touch with a very nice guy called Larry Finger, who maintains most of the real tech drivers. And he managed to find a bunch of bugs in the cleanups that I've been doing to the driver. And we managed to fix most of the hands that we were seeing. And then, I'm pretty good at Googling as well. So, I managed to find some of the patches that we needed. Non-upstream, hey, I've been using that for a year and it works fine. You know, somebody from the Unaro sending patches and telling you, you need that patch, but not actually getting it upstream because, you know, maybe he was going on holidays and forgot about it. Windows 8 doesn't support on the go. So I've got my Windows tablet. If I put it in Android mode, then I can use USB on the go. Windows 8 doesn't support USB on the go. The Windows 8 devices are fully fledged computers. They are the ones that are supposed to control your phone. You don't control the Windows tablet from another Windows phone, another Windows device. So, Windows 8 doesn't support USB on the go, and the hardware doesn't support USB on the go. You've got a SoC which has USB on the go support, except that it's disabled by default because they don't want to be paying the couple of pennies that it would cost to actually build the little wire to make the hardware work. So you've got some hardware inside your data tablet that doesn't actually do anything, that's just dead because an OEM didn't want to spend a couple of pennies that it would have cost to get it working. But we've got access to other data cables. This is a Belkin data transfer cable. If you've never seen those, you might remember Laplink from the 1990s. You want to be able to send some data from one Windows computer to the other. Networks weren't that as widely available as they are today. So you could buy a serial cable from one machine to the other, and you would be able to transfer data. If you buy something like that nowadays, in Windows 8 and in Windows 10, you just plug it in on either end, and suddenly you've got a network between the two machines. You launch the data migration application, and you can move all the data from one machine to the other, and vice versa. And the good thing is, well, we should be able to use those devices to communicate with our data tablet that doesn't support USB on the go. So we need to try and get that working. There are some attempts to get proper drivers for them. Right now, if you use them on Linux, they are very flaky and they work as network adapters. EFI Mix doesn't work yet. So you can actually boot the 64-bit OS on those Bayrock tablets with a 32-bit EFI. But EFI Mix doesn't work, so you need to boot them into legacy mode. That also does break some of the drivers that try to access EFI afterwards. It doesn't work yet, but we are very close to getting it working. Then, because we weren't able to get the cable working, and because we're not able to run the 64-bit OS on the tablet yet, we don't have XDG app patches. We also don't have builder integration. But you can see where I'm going with all this. We have a list of tasks, some of them are blocking, some of them are not, where once we actually go through them, we should be able to implement everything that I talked about in the first part. That means that we should be able to do very much like in Android, start building your application locally on your laptop, on your desktop. You have a cable all the way to your tablet, press a button, deploy on the tablet, you'll be able to test it with the touchscreen, with the form factor, with all the hardware and the devices that it's got built in. And that's pretty much it. No refunds. I'm very sorry that I lied to you in that first part. But we still need to do quite a bit of work to be able to achieve what we set out, what the title was of this presentation. Builder support is going to be coming. XDG app support is going to be coming. We still need bundles to be a thing in XDG app. Looking at you, Alex. And very soon we'll have a good developer experience for people trying to test smaller, less powerful devices. That's great. That's me. Any questions? Well, this is going to be quick. Yeah?
What was the funniest thing you found in the source code you removed from the project?
In the source code I removed? I think that it was support for pre-production.
No. What was the funniest thing you found?
The funniest thing I found?
In the code.
In the code. I think that the funniest thing that I saw is probably something that I couldn't read because it was, you know, all the comments are in Chainrich. So, yeah, there's when you get drivers from the vendors, they are usually pretty bad. I did work on the wireless driver, but this one didn't get upstream yet because it's broken in so many ways. What I did manage to get upstream is the touchscreen driver, which is used in a number of other tablets because apparently it's a very cheap touch panel. And that particular one, we did manage to get upstream. But yeah, it was tens of thousands of lines of code as well. Most of it didn't actually do anything. And we managed to cut it down. Mind you, we did remove one or two features for which we didn't have specifications, but we managed to cut it down to about 200 or 300 lines of code from the, you know, tens of thousands. So this is one of the reasons why vendors, especially those who make these those building blocks of devices, you get the drivers upstream into the Linux kernel, so that, you know, there's somebody actually testing them and making sure they everything works. Yeah, Cosimo?
Do you think, is there anything that we can do as a community to improve the situation going forward for future products?
What can we do as a community to make sure that we go forward and you know, that it's a better experience? I think that the best thing that you can do is look around, look on Amazon, look on, you know, your local electronics retailer's website. There are some very cheap devices that that can already run Windows. Usually when they run Windows 8 or Windows 8.1, this is a good indication that that you're going to be able to run Linux on it. I'm not saying that you will be able to get everything working, but even if you go to a store, you might be able to open up the hardware manager in Windows that's installed and see what devices it's got inside, where they got the Wi-Fi, where they got the various building blocks again of the for that device, and you can make an educated guess as to whether it's going to run Linux all right or not. Alex,
you are obviously the guy that's figure out if we have GNOME running well on some particular cheap machine, could you like post it on the wiki and everyone else know what would work and what type of item?
So you wanted me to run the test for everyone else and tell all the folks
it would be cool because then you could get more people in the community testing.
So I think that my cheap tablet buying days, I think that the bug spread to a couple of other folks. He's three people in this room that have the exact same tablet that I used to. This Honda tablet. But you can also buy in the US, for example, a $70 7-inch tablet from Micro Center that can run Linux. There are still some bugs, but it's software, they are bugs. Most of the time, it's going to be taking a punt because the hardware that you can get in one country is not going to be the same one as in another. But saying that, you should be able to get hardware that's going to resemble an awful lot the hardware that's already on the market for which we've already got support, because there are only so many providers of those building blocks. There are only so many Wi-Fi drivers and Wi-Fi chipsets that are going to work and that are going to be cheap enough to put in those type of machines. So I would say you go to your local store, you check online, and you can probably pick up even a 10-inch tablet for about €120, I think. It's going to have Windows on it. Windows is free for those size devices. So, yeah, if you can run Windows on it, it's a pretty good guess. Might need a bit of poking. But most of the work that I've been trying to do, getting EFI Mix working, if we get EFI Mix working, that means that we can get Secure Boot working. That means that, for example, the next Fedora or the whatever distribution you use that's got support for Secure Boot, it should just work out of the box. You blitz the image onto the USB key, you plug that into your tablet, and with a little bit of hardware, USB hub and a USB keyboard, you should be able to boot it, install it, and actually just get started. Then you can start contacting developers, driver developers, to see what can be done about getting support for all the different hardware. I was chatting yesterday with somebody from Yola. They've also got some hardware that's very close to, hardware, and for example, they've got some support for the cameras that are built into those machines. This is something that we should try and get them to upstream, because they probably have a better understanding of what's necessary to get it merged, and that means that it's yet another piece of hardware that we can get working. But as with an awful lot of hardware, if you go to an ODM and you tell them, I want to run Linux on it, they're probably going to send you Android drivers. And then Android drivers aren't Linux drivers, not really. Any other questions?
The XPG app install stuff, I assume that's going to need to be the runtime over as well, right? So
how is XPG app install going to work when it works? Well, I think that first of all, we'll probably need to have a way for bundles to be installed on the target machine. But that, as soon as we have something that doesn't require an HTTP web server to get installed, and we can get bundles that are very close to what the Android APK actually are, just a tarball with a manifest and all that information, we should be able to say, well, the runtime is not installed on the target machine, I'm going to install the runtime, I'm going to install the application. And because of the way that ACG app is built, it would be pretty straightforward. We would have the runtime with the application if it's not needed by anything else. I think that the amount of work that will be necessary in ACG app is probably not going to be in the integration with APB install. It's probably going to be more about making sure that we can have bundles of files that we don't need, you know, a complicated setup to be able to deploy. Because you really don't want to need networking working to be able to install your applications.
Yeah, I mean, you also want to be able to disable networking testing your application.
Yeah, you want to be able to disable network, certainly. You had a question, Alex.
Yeah, and how does the actual AV install work? Do you have your own? Is the machine fully booted, or are you?
I didn't explain at which point ADB actually runs. On Android devices, you've got two things. You've got fastboot, which is a USB interface to the firmware, and this is usually where you will switch on or switch off developer mode, for example. This is where you're going to tell it, this is the file and this is the kernel that you're going to use to boot. One of the interesting things about fastboot is that you don't need to copy files onto the device. It's very temporary, so the firmware grabs those files that you sent it and will boot with those, and it will be forgotten the next time. So it's great for doing hardware enablement, for example, like fixing kernel bugs. ADBD runs within, it's a system daemon, you know, at the same level as, you know, all of systemd or your network daemons that would be running on the machine.
So it's a fully booted system.
So it's a fully booted system, yeah.
Should we end up making something like, I mean, I assume that we can't just get fastboot working on this hardware because it requires bootloader integration. Does it make sense maybe to do something similar as in like a grub or gummy boot extension, so that if you set an EFI variable, you know, we can say the next boot is going to be a fast boot, gummy boot could wait for a network connection.
Can we replace fast boot with our bootloader that we would control? Possibly, but I think that it would be fairly difficult because, as you've seen, we don't have USB OTG support on those starting machines. That means that you will need, within that bootloader, you will need support for whatever data cable you end up using. I don't think that we want to support only one data cable. It would be quite a bit of work. You would have written already user space code to communicate with that, to communicate through that data cable in the OS itself, and then we need to re-implement that in the bootloader. And that's if, and I don't know whether that's the truth or not, whether you've got USB stack support inside the inside either EFI or the bootloader.
Are all of those big transfer cables double embed network?
It's supposed to be, it does host to host, so you can plug it in whichever.
So it doesn't fake it, but is there that blob in the middle?
If there's a blob in the middle, and I'm guessing that there is something inside it, like in the middle, that, you know, does its magic, makes it. I mean, it's not that different from a couple of twisted pairs running through maybe a very cheap network hub, you know. transfers for PlayStation developers. It's the exact same chipset. It's from a company called Prolific.
So if that's out of the question, I'm thinking about the iteration on this. Could we do something like an ad hoc network on the on the builder machine with a TFTP server and actually do networking on these pages up out to like from the BIOSes that I've looked at, they do have a network boot support.
Yeah, network boot support.
And they have a wireless card, so I'm presuming they have the ability to, I mean, even MacBooks can move off the network with encrypted support now.
Well, the firmware on the MacBooks is very different.
Right.
So the question was whether we can do network boot on those devices. I'm guessing that it all depends on whether the firmware's actually got support for the hardware that's inside. Can you do network at EFI level? If you can, then maybe we can do something. I don't think that's something very standard, and I'm guessing that there are people more knowledgeable in EFI to be able to answer that question. But it would certainly be something very interesting to check out, especially if we know that we've got support for this sort of thing. Maybe we'll be able to reuse some of that stack inside the OS itself.
The good news is the three bay trail tablets I've used all had network boot, but I don't know to what degree. They can boot off like an encrypted lab or...
So apparently all the bay trail tablets he's got can boot up the network. Well, this is something that we'll have to test. Any other questions? Well, thank you very much for your time, and thank you for getting up this early in the dark rain. Thank you.